Hi everyone, I'm Sully from The Sully Show. If you haven't watched part one yet, you might want to do so by clicking the box right over here. In that episode, we were talking to Terry Fator about what happened to his original puppets when he was on America's Got Talent. Here's part two and the rest of his answer.
I didn't realize. I thought if you bought a puppet that you were pretty much paying for the ride. You know, I was clueless. I'd never had any kind of exposure to the big time at all. So, right. You know, I just had these puppets that we bought at a toy store, you know, that I figured that if you paid for them, you were paying to use them, but apparently not. I make sure and warn a lot of the younger ventriloquists that are coming out. I say, listen, before you go on any kind of national exposure, get permission from the makers of the puppet. Right. Puppets that, and the great thing is a lot of the big puppet makers who, the people who make Winston, are the same ones who work on the Jim Henson puppets.
Oh, very cool.
But people like Steve Axtell, who is a phenomenal puppet maker, and he's one of those that understands that if you use his puppet on national television, it's good for him.
Right.
So he's one of the great ones that will not sue you for using one of his puppets on national TV. So, you know, if there's anybody out there and you're wondering where to get a puppet, axtell.com, AXTELL.com. Great puppet maker. He makes Vicky the Cougar. Have you seen Vicky the Cougar in any of my bios?
I have.
Yeah,
now, how did Vicky come about?
You know, she's based – I went to Hollywood right after America's Got Talent. I started spending a lot of time in L.A. and doing, talk shows and other things.
Right.
And seriously, I was a Texas boy. I grew up thinking that all that stuff was just movies. And I actually met women that looked like they were made out of plastic. I couldn't believe it. I mean, they had these gigantic, like, boobs that were way bigger than they could possibly naturally have.
Right.
And of course, they're in their 60s and 50s, late 50s and 60s. And their faces are stretched, you know. It's just nuts. I couldn't believe that people like that actually existed. I thought that was only, like, characters in movies. So I said, I got to have a character like this. I got to get myself a cougar puppet. And she says she's had a lot of plastic surgery, so much that they used real plastic. So.
so.
Nice.
Things that you pretty much experience in life, that's how you get your basic idea for a lot of your characters, correct?
Exactly. And like I said, Winston came about because I needed someone who could do an impression of a frog. And I wanted to get either an amphibian or a reptile. And of course, I ended up with a turtle. Just because I thought it was cute. And then he sort of became the, I can impress any, I mean, I can do an impression of anybody. And you do impress everybody.
I do?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. So, but yeah, he does impressions. So he's kind of my default. So if I have a character, if I have a voice that I want to do and I can't think of anybody else, Winston, you know, does that.
Exactly.
Now, I also know that and this is actually before America's Got Talent, because I have known about you for before that. Because someone a couple of years ago posted a video of you doing Sonny and Cher.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what year it was that they actually took the video of you.
It was probably a long time ago. I started doing Sonny and Cher, maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And so I was doing. I've been doing impressions of singers since I was young. I had a little jackal puppet, or it was kind of lion, you know, an animal puppet. I called him Jackal Mikes, and he would do Michael Jackson songs when I was 10.
Good play on words.
So I've been doing impressions, and I had this cowboy puppet that would do impressions of Dwight Yoakam and Garth Brooks and stuff. And it's so interesting because it never occurred to me, because it came so naturally for me, it absolutely never occurred to me that it might capture the hearts of America. I was trying to get a Las Vegas show just as a singer. And then when I went and saw an actual impressionist in Las Vegas named Danny Gantz, you remember Danny?
Yes. Yes, Danny I do, Gantz. Actually. Yeah.
He was amazing. And he went from one impression to another. And I saw the crowd. And people paid $100 a ticket to see him.
Wow.
I did too. And I thought, oh my gosh, I got to focus on this. I got to make this the really the focus of what I do.
Right.
Except I need to have all the puppets do the impressions instead of myself so I can be different from Danny. Mm-hmm. And that's really how it all started. In 2005, I decided after seeing Danny Gans that I was going to turn all of my puppets into impressionists. Nice. And boy, I never dreamed it would – you know, I never dreamed that I would go from America's Got Talent, winning it, to headlining at the Las Vegas Hilton, and then settling on a long-term deal at the Mirage. I thought I would end up going to a smaller casino and building my way up and hopefully one day getting to a place like the Mirage. But boy, it just really, it's unprecedented. It never in the history of Vegas has anyone ever gone from complete obscurity to headlining at a major casino for a long term without building their way up. So it's really bizarre how this happened.
But in a lot of ways, you did build yourself up because you have the years of experience doing this. I mean, like you said, you were in a band way before America's Got Talent.
No, you definitely paid your dues.
No, I did pay my dues. I mean, I started doing ventriloquism when I was 10. I did that all the way through high school and college. And then I started a band right after I got out of college. And did that for 15 years until I was in my late 30s. And then I started doing ventriloquism by itself. So I paid my dues. But what I meant was it was unprecedented that someone who had never really played Vegas before just shot to the headliner at a major casino. And I was unknown before America's Got Talent. But unbeknownst to me, the president of the Mirage watched me on America's Got Talent and really kind of brought together the heads of the MGM and said, listen, I think this may be our next headliner. I didn't know that, of course. And then when the Las Vegas Hilton decided to give me a trial, our first two shows sold out in 4 hours.
Wow.
It was unbelievable. I mean, it was just like the impact that show had was incredible.
Of course, he did have a turtle.
Right, I did.
Very true. And Winston Howard.
If you want to play Vegas, get yourself a turtle who can sing.
Right. I mean, it's kind of obvious, isn't it?
Yeah, I agree. I mean,
makes
I wish I could.
Sense to me.
I wish I could do what you do. That'd be awesome. I've always wanted to do the voice of a Muppet. At least they won't be able to see me, you know. Because I can't talk with my mouth
that way.
I can't be. I know I can't be a ventriloquism, but at least I know I can do different voices. And speaking of voices, like how many different voices would you say that you could actually impersonate? Not just singers, but all in all?
Oh, I can do well over 100. You know, I never actually counted, but I mean, if you look at all the voices I've done throughout the years, you know, and I mostly I do singing impressions, but I do, you know, I can do cartoon voices mostly. I try to do others. And for some reason, I just can't seem to latch on. I probably could if I wanted to, but mm-hmm. I'm not as interested in real people as I am cartoons.
Makes sense.
Cartoons are so much easier to deal with.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
less egos with cartoons.
That's a fact.
Very true. Now, Punchy, you had a question for Terry, correct?
Yeah, actually, a few, because I mean, I do comedy, so I'm in the early stages of it. Now, you were in that Texas area for a little bit. I know that in the 80s, about that, had a like, pretty big comedy scene there. Were you in the middle of any of that, or was that more like you were further from there and?
No, none at all. I was in Dallas, and I lived right outside of Dallas, and we did. But you know, it's weird. I was never the comedy clubs would never take me because I was a ventriloquist, and until you know, Jeff Dunham really kind of fixed that for the comedy club because once they saw I was a ventriloquist, they would instantly throw my stuff in the trash, so they didn't even look at me, and it was that way for a very long time. And Jeff Dunham came along and started doing like the Tonight Show, and made him start going maybe we should look at this. But by that time, I was already doing really, really well playing fairs and other things. I was making probably five times the amount at a fair that I would have at a comedy club. So I was much more happy doing the fairs. And same thing with schools. That's why I was doing schools. I was making, you know, I went from in about a span. I started in 2000 and 2001, and I think I made $8,000 in 2001. As my first, or maybe it was it was 2002 because it was right after 9/11. I went solo and I made $8,000 my first year as a ventriloquist. And within 2 years, starting to play fairs and schools, I was making over $100,000 just doing it. I was working 3 to 5 shows a day, and I was working 12 months a year. So it was you know, there was no days off, there was no time off. So it was very difficult, but I was making a good living at it, you know. I'm not sure what they're barking at. But
no idea.
They want to get involved in the interview.
Yeah, right?
Hey, everyone. Thanks for checking out part two of our interview with Terry Fator. If you haven't done so already, you can check out part one at the top window and part three right below it. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/TheSullyShow, at The Sully Show on Twitter. Click the subscribe button. And, of course, don't forget to check out Terry Fader's tour dates, terryfader.com. You can also follow him on Twitter as well, at Terry Fader. Go to his Facebook page as well. And as always, The Sully Show is live Sundays, noon to 2 Eastern on morelikeradio.com. Stick around for part three. We'll see you.